to you by the Institute of Life Insurance on behalf of the life insurance companies in America and their agents trained to help you make the most of your policy. And now let's all play What's My Line? And now, live from New York, let's meet our What's My Line panel. First, the delightful star of the Broadway smash hit Dinner at Eight, Miss Arlene Francis.
And now, a friendly gentleman who has just completed the musical score for a new picture called A Man Called Dagger. And he is the host of I've Got a Secret, Mr. Steve Allen.
Thank you. Now, I'd like to introduce a young lady with a great many strings to her bow. She's an author of bestsellers, editor of Cosmopolitan magazine, bon vivant, eminent Viennese medical authority, and all sorts of things. Here she is, all three of her, Helen Gurley Brown.
And this panelist is so many things. He's a publisher, an author, a TV personality, a lecturer, and Time Magazine's Christmas cover boy, Mr. Bennett Cerf.
What does Viennese medical authority business?
I don't know. I didn't know it was me.
I'm hoping I'm going to get on the cover of Cosmopolitan someday.
Oh, wonderful.
Well, here is New York's best imitation of Santa Claus, which will give you some idea of how hard up we are around here. John Francis Kris Kringle Daly.
I don't know. I was full of the spirit of the season, was going to say nice things about him, too. Nice things I was going to say. We did get a telephone call a little bit ago, Bennett. I didn't get who it was from, but it was somebody calling from Columbus, Georgia, who'd read the cover story in the current time about you. And the message sent was that people who ride a wave of prosperity are actually surfing. Don't get it, huh? I'll explain it to you afterwards.
Thank you.
Really, it's quite good. Yes, rather. And may I say, Miss Brown, nice to have you here. Steve, it's a Christmas present for us to have an old and trusted and dear and valued friend like you back just before Christmas gets you. How's
Thank
your
you,
cold?
Chance. My pleasure. Thank you.
How's your cold?
It's very young.
See, Bennett didn't realize. I know why you wanted that Viennese medical authority there. Steve's got a cold. He wants a doctor to sit next to.
Created my own.
Well, we've got some wonderful occupations for you to test your skills on tonight. We'll have a famous mystery guest a little bit later in the program, but now let's meet our first contestant. Will you enter and sign in, please?
Jehan Waba, is that right?
Thank you. I thought my Arabic was rather good, too. You have a very fine hand, I might also add.
Thank you.
Would you tell us, is it Miss or Mrs. Waba?
Miss.
Miss Waba. Where are you from?
Cairo, Egypt.
From Cairo. Ah, that's a wonderful city. I've been there several times, and I must say it's a fascinating city, full of life and spirit. Nice to have you with us. Miss Waba, may I present the panel? Now, would you join me over here, please? And we'll let the audience in the theater and the audience at home know exactly what your line is. All right. Panel, we can tell you that Miss Waba is salaried and deals in a service, and we'll begin things with Steve Allen.
John, I've been on this program now, man and boy, about 16 years, and I've never before done what I would classify as a Bennett Cerf type pun. I'm going to do one right now. You ready, Bennett?
No.
I'll just put it this way. Miss Waba, you're a doll. A Waba doll. You see? I have the genre down, I think. Well, would your service be of equal interest to men and women, Miss Waba?
Yes.
Do you dress as you do now when you perform your service?
No.
One down and nine to go. Miss Brown.
Could it be said you wear some kind of costume when you're performing your service?
Well, costume or uniform, yes. We use the terms interchangeably, so that would be right.
Do you work indoors?
Sometimes.
Is any of your work seasonal? Is it more performed in the winter than in the summer?
No.
No, it's not seasonal. Two down and eight to go, Mr. Sir.
Ms. Waba, do you work for a profit-making organization?
No.
You don't.
Three down and seven to go, Miss Francis.
Then you work for some branch of the government?
Yes.
Is the outfit that you wear an outfit that belongs to any of the armed service?
No.
Four down and six to go, Mr. Allen.
Can people ever be made unhappy as a result of your professional function?
No.
Five down and five to go, Helen Gurley Brown.
Do you perform this service in the United States now?
No.
Six down and four to go, Mr. Sir.
Do you perform the service in Egypt, Ms. Waba?
Yes.
Has it got anything to do with tourism?
Yes.
Would it be anything in the line of guiding?
Yes.
Do I have to know where you guide
people? Well, Bennett, I would say
would
in fairness...
Would be on the Nile or around the pyramids?
Right, that's what we were looking for. Miss Waba is a guide at the pyramids. Actually, they have sound and light, magnificent sound and light performances at the three best-known pyramids. And Miss Waba, who is a historian, I guess we'd have to call you, too. You have to know a great deal about the history of Egypt to do this. Have to be a university graduate. You speak how many languages?
English, French, German, and my Arabic.
Four languages. Wears a navy blue uniform.
Ms. Waba, you should tell Mr. Daly about that Sphinx that's there, you know, that never talks, right next to the pyramids.
It did talk.
Yes, at the Sound and Light Show.
The Sphinx talked?
Yeah, at the Sound and Light Show. I've been over there, Bennett. You don't think I'd let that keep quiet while I'm around, do you? Heavenly days now. No, it is a very interesting work. You must have met an awful lot of well-known people.
From all different parts of the world, and like King Hussein of Jordan and Macarius of Crete and Mrs. Gandhi and Mr. Khrushchev.
Any Americans?
Mr.
You remember?
One of the Rockefellers.
That's pretty good.
So many.
That's pretty good. We have a lot of the Rockefellers here, but if they got all the way to Cairo, that must be one of the older ones and the ones who've done better, would you say? No, I wouldn't think so. Well, it sounds like fascinating work, and thank you very much for coming to visit us while you're in America. It's nice to see you. We'll have another contestant for you in just a moment after this word.
Honey, I've been thinking about retirement.
At 35?
No, I'm just planning ahead.
What do you mean?
Well, I was talking to our life insurance man today, and he told me that when I retire, I can get paid regularly from my own policies.
That's wonderful.
I thought so.
And you'd still be alive, of course.
Yes, that's the nice part of it.
How long will you get these payments?
You won't believe this.
Try me.
Well, he says the life insurance company will pay us the same amount every month as long as either one of us lives.
Really?
Positively.
And you've included me.
Well, you're my wife and all.
Your only wife. I'm unique that way.
That's funny.
What?
He says life insurance is unique. It's the only way you can guarantee retirement pay you can't outlive.
Unique. Your wife and your life insurance. I think that shows what a really warm human being you are.
See your life insurance agent. He's trained to help you make the most of your policies.
Now will our next contestant walk in and please sign the board.
Raymond Kester, is that right, sir? All right, Mr. Kester, where are you from?
Shrewsbury, Missouri.
Shrewsbury, Missouri. Yeah. Well, now you see you've got a lot of them home folks here with you, so you've got a good clack going for you, and the two of us could take the whole panel on anyway, so don't worry about that. Mr. Kester, may I present the panel? All right, now would you come over here and join me, and we'll let the audience at home and the audience in the theater know exactly what your line is. Panel, we can tell you that Mr. Kester is salaried and he deals in a product. And we will begin things with Bennett, sir.
Mr. Kester, I think they make the corncob pipes in Missouri, but may I eliminate corncob pipes from this?
Absolutely.
I can. Does the product that you make come from Missouri?
No. You mean it originates there, so you would identify it in
Missouri
immediately?
Product.
No, you wouldn't, Bennett. That's one down and nine to go, Miss Francis.
Do you work with your hands, Mr. Kester, in your
job?
Is the product alive, or has it ever been?
Yes.
John didn't know whether it was alive or not there for a minute.
Well, this is a problem, because actually, you know, if we go down to fundamentals, everything has an element of life in it sooner or later. If Mr. Kester doesn't mind, only because I think it would tend to confuse you.
No, it won't.
It won't? You
no.
want to leave it stand as it is?
I'm not at all confused, John.
All right, you go ahead then.
Is it a product that one would find in the home?
Could.
Is it a large product?
No.
That makes it two down and eight to go at Mr. L.
Then it must be smaller than a bread box.
Yes.
Has it any particular relationship with this time of year?
No, sir.
Three down and seven to go. Helen Gurley Brown.
Mr. Kester, is it made of wood or metal?
No.
That makes it four down and six to go. Mr. Sir.
Might this product be defined as an article of apparel, Mr. Kester?
No.
Five down and five to go. Miss Francis.
Would one see it in the house more than one would out of doors?
Yes.
Is it, when it is in the house, is it visible? Would you have it out where people could see it?
Yes.
Or would it be considered, does it have anything at all to do with the decor of a house, the way a house looks?
You mean as a specific element of its decoration? Nah, all right, I'll give you a no anyway. That's six down and four to go, Mr. Allen.
Could it be purchased retail at a supermarket?
No, sir.
Nope. Seven down and three to go, Miss Brown.
Does it come in various colors?
Yes.
Is it a useful product?
Yes.
Does it come in contact with a human body?
No.
Well, there is...
Could it?
I think with Mr. Kester said, we'll agree that it could. It's not unreasonable that if the product and you were in proximity, you might have contact with it, but it is not absolutely necessary.
Does one feel better after... being in contact with this product? Is it?
I would think so, yes.
Well, I think it depends on how you contacted it myself. But...
Does it have, is it powered in any way?
No.
By a motor?
It has no motors of any kind. Eight down and two to go,
Mr.
Sir.
I don't believe we've gotten around to whether this product can be eaten or imbibed.
We haven't.
Can it?
No. Nine down and one to go, Miss Francis.
If one had this product, would it be on the floor rather than on a wall?
Yes.
Well, on the floor rather than on the wall, this product, but it shouldn't be out of place, so I'm going to give you no. That's 10 down, no more to go.
Wouldn't be on the ceiling, would it?
No.
It has to be on something?
Yeah, actually, this is a real tough one, and you didn't get into the area which I think might have led you to it, because Mr. Kester makes billiard balls. Mr. Kester makes, you know, the really championship kind. He's with
A.E. Schmidt Company.
A.E. Schmidt Company. He's been in the business
for 116 years, and I've been with him for 40 years.
1850, then. And he's been with him for 40 years, and he hand makes ivory billiard balls, which, you know, the best books. They age the ivory. What kind of ivory do you get?
Zanzibar from Africa.
Africa, and then what? You age it
after it's roughed out, all year to 2 years, before we can put them on the, for use.
But the thing that interested me most, looking this up, Mr. Kester affirms that as you use them, they tend to become oval-shaped. So you have to send them back. Do they send them back to you, and then he makes them round again?
Mr. Kester, are pool balls beneath your contempt?
Yeah.
You don't make pool balls.
No, we don't make those.
Yes, I bet it. Don't be bad. Don't feel unhappy. I'll find somebody who does. Yeah.
I'd like you to donate this money I won to the Boys Town of Missouri of St. James, Missouri, for the Christmas. And I'd also have two ivory rings that I would like to present to the Mrs. Brown. And
well, you go right ahead, and thanks very much for being with us, sir. We'll meet tonight's mystery guest in just a moment, but first, this message.
Now, with colds and flu on the rise, your luck may not hold out. So be prepared to follow the three steps doctors recommend for colds and flu. Rest in bed, drink plenty of fluids, and take aspirin to reduce fever and relieve pain. Bayer is pure aspirin, not just part aspirin. And aspirin is the pain reliever doctors recommend. So keep your fingers crossed, but keep Bayer aspirin handy. When your luck runs out, Bayer works wonders.
If you're one of the millions of people who sometimes rely on a laxative, take the best laxative, Phillips Milk of Magnesia. When thousands of doctors across the country were asked, "Do you ever recommend Milk of Magnesia?" the overwhelming majority said they did. You see, Phillips Milk of Magnesia is a laxative plus an antacid. No single-purpose laxative can give such complete yet gentle relief. Take Phillips Milk of Magnesia, the kind of laxative doctors recommend.
And now the special feature of our program, the appearance of our mystery challenger, for which the panel is always blindfolded, as you know. The blindfold's in place, panel?
Yes, sir.
Good. Will you enter mystery challenger and sign in, please? You will remember the different form of questioning, one question at a time, in turn moving clockwise. And we will begin with Arlene Francis.
Would your name be found in the theatrical pages of the newspaper?
Well, it's a possibility.
What?
Mr. Allen, it's a possibility.
Are you better known for your work in motion pictures than for your work in television?
Yeah, well, I reckon so.
Miss Brown? Said, I reckon so.
Better known in motion pictures than in television. Are you in a motion picture that's going to be opening in New York this coming week?
Yeah.
Mr. Cerf?
Is it a great, big, spectacular, the picture that you're going to open in?
Well, you've been a little question about it.
Miss Francis?
Are you Steve McQueen?
That was a great voice. I was just waiting for somebody to go off the track on it.
Yeah, you open tomorrow. Is it tomorrow night or Tuesday night?
Well, we have the premiere Tuesday night, yeah.
Premiere the Tuesday Theater. Night, yeah. The Sand Pebbles,
the
huh?
The Sand Pebbles, yes. Yeah. That was 9 months in the Orient.
Had a little trouble making that picture, didn't you?
Well, we had a few weather interferences. Wind from Manchuria and the tides went out and 1,500 extras wearing wristwatches in a period piece. But other than that,
wait a minute, Steve. You mean that you shot a scene and you had 1,500 extras wearing wristwatches and had to do it all over again?
Well, we had a problem because there were three different dialects there and we only had one interpreter, and it was in 1924, so the 1,500 extras had to be in period clothes, you see.
Yeah.
And they would constantly wear the wristwatches. They wouldn't take them off, you know. So they'd be flashing them up in the camera like this, you know. We had to stop, take it off, you know.
Did you say you spent 9 months out there?
We spent 4.5 months in Taiwan and Formosa and Keelong, Tamsui, places where actually people hadn't seen a movie, you know. And then we did about 4 months in 3.5 months in Kowloon in the New Territories.
Oh, yes.
About 2 months, two miles from the communist border, and that last 2 months was really, it was a little scary.
Yeah, that's exciting up there.
Yeah.
But now, when you go out and work, you had 1,500 of the native population, the indigenous population, as extras?
Yes. Not in all scenes. Yeah. Some of the scenes we had where the gunboat is coming in, we had 1,500 extras, yeah. All the wardrobe that we brought from Hollywood, some we made there, dressed them up so they would look the part, you see.
And do they take direction readily? I'm just interested. You have to work with such a mass of people who you had communications problems and speech, and yet they can get the feel of what you're trying to do and do it well.
Well, it was a bit difficult, but we had Bob Wise. So we kind of had it made. We had an awful good director and producer, but we had, there were three dialects. There was the Cantonese, Chinese, and Taiwanese. Now, we had one interpreter who perhaps spoke Cantonese, so he would give the orders to the extras, you know, to do this, and the other ones didn't understand, you know. And then we'd be fighting about, well, why don't we have an interpreter? And it would keep going and going and going.
That's what Well, it's an exciting story, and I'm sure it's made a great movie. Thanks for giving us a Sunday night when you're here in New York.
My pleasure.
Good to have you with us. Congratulate your panel on doing rather well with some tough subjects tonight. We'll have another contestant after this word.
Ladies and gentlemen, I got a little trick for you. I'm going to make a billfold appear out of thin air. Here it is, the Lord Buxton Organizer. As you can see, it's flat to match your head, or even a friend's. And there's a secret compartment here, too. I can't tell you, it's a secret. Then there's a special place for cards. Six on one side, six on the other, making a total of 131. For my next trick, I take this hanky and place it over the entire hat. Pull it off, and zingo! Norma? Ooh. Oh, thank you, my dear. And here it is, the Buxton Flashlight Key Tainer. Flashlight, keys, and the tainer. Only $3.95. And the organizer, $5.95 up, never down. They make excellent gifts. And I will now show you how to make an entire body disappear.
And now to meet a final contestant. Will you enter and sign in, please?
Peter Hayes, right, sir? Mr. Hayes, where are you from?
Newark, New Jersey.
Newark, New Jersey.
Yes.
Nice to have you come across the river. May I present the panel, Mr. Hayes? Now, will you join me here, and we'll let the audience in the theater and the audience at home know exactly what your line is. All right. Panel, we can tell you that Mr. Hayes is salaried and deals in a service, and we'll begin things with Helen Gurley Brown.
Now, this one must have something to do with Christmas. Do you work for a profit-making organization?
Yes.
Do you deal with men and women in this particular service? With human beings as opposed to animals, I'll say?
No.
One down and nine to go, Mr. Sir.
Mr. Hayes, I just want to be sure you're no relation of Peter Hayes is married to that gloriously beautiful Mary Healy. Is that correct?
That's correct.
But you do have something to do with animals, is that correct?
That's correct.
Is that a tie-up?
No tie-up, whatever. Are the animals alive when you're dealing with them?
Yes.
Are they what might be considered domestic animals?
No.
Let us have a small conference. Mr. Hayes agrees that you use the word domesticated, and we're taking it that you mean this on a universal basis. And we will agree that there are areas in which the animal in question is domesticated, yes.
Is it a four-legged animal, Mr.
Yes.
Is it a rather large animal?
Yes.
Is it a very, very large animal?
What is a very, very large animal?
An elephant.
An elephant is a very, very large?
I didn't ask an elephant, but you asked me a large animal, and I described a large animal as an elephant.
Well, now, what else would you describe as a large animal?
A hippopotamus, a rhinoceros,
so that you're in
a giraffe.
That, in that context. All right, well, I think, just so that you're not misled, we'll agree it's a large animal, yes.
Is it an animal that is sometimes found in the wilderness?
You mean out in the belt?
Yeah, the wide belt.
Wide, wide belt? Yeah, you find it out in the wide, wide belt, right?
Yeah.
Might this animal be found in Africa?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Is it sometimes dangerous, this animal?
Can be, yes.
It could be if aroused, but then even you're dangerous when you're aroused. Right?
Can I eliminate lions and tigers?
Yes.
Can I eliminate the cat family, leopards and animals of that sort?
Yes.
Can I eliminate giraffes?
Yes.
Can I eliminate elephants?
Yes.
And rhinoceri and hippopotami?
You yes. certainly can.
What do we got out there?
And it's a four-legged animal.
Right.
I'll pass.
You've left me with nothing but the gorilla. Is it an animal we see in a zoo?
Yep.
Yes.
We're running out of time, Arlene.
We've run out of animals, too.
Could it be reindeer or camel?
Camel is right.
Oh, a camel.
Very good. Well, Mr. Hayes wins. Actually, Mr. Hayes handles the camel in the Christmas stage show at Radio City Music Hall.
Oh.
That's his especially. He's employed by an outfit called Animal Talent Scouts. And he's in the show and handles his own camel through it. And that's a lucky strike if I ever saw one. And thank you very much for being our guest on What's My Line. Nice to see you. Miss Helen and Steve, again, nice to have you with us. And Christmas is coming up, so Merry Christmas and Merry Christmas and Happy New Year and all that sort of thing. And good night, Arlene Francis.
Thank you, John. Good night, dear Steve. My best to Jane.
Thank you. Same to Marty. Good night, Helen Gurley Brown.
Good night, John. Steve. Good night, Dennis.
Good night. For Christmas, John, I'm going to sing you Winchester Cathedral. Good night.
Well, I'd rather you did it for Christmas because it'd be a terrible way to start a new year. That's all I got to say. And thanks to all of you for being with us on What's My Line.
Is a CBS Television Network production in association with Mark Goodson and Bill Todman. Miss Frances Gowan is from Bond with Teller. This is Johnny Olson speaking. Brought to you by Buxton, the people who make leather accessories for men and women.
Are you watching, you little rascals?
Oh, it's fun, isn't it?
And who subscribes to it?
Go on, push the button.
Think of the fun you could have on
the tube.
The tube?
You.
Tube.
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 TV tubes.
That's a lot of fun, isn't it?
It's going to be a lot more fun
if you keep going the way you're going.
Go on,
push the button.
Please subscribe. Subscribe.
I hope they're watching.